So I'm basically a storyteller, and I will very briefly share with you one or two stories which I feel are fair wind in the sails of this ship, this mission. So the first one is about a moment in the Ramayana, which to our friends from outside India is pretty much the predominant epic, at least in North India. And there is a moment where the hero of the story, who is the incarnation of Vishnu, Lord Rama, has to build a bridge to go from the southern coast of India to Sri Lanka. And the bridge is being built by all the animals of the forest, because he has only the animals of the forest as his friends and fellow travelers. They are putting stones that float in the water, and so the bridge is being built. And at this moment, two squirrels come to Bhagwan Ram, and they say, "Bhai, we also want to help." So he says, "But what will you do? Because, you know, big stones need to be lifted, and it's very sweet of you to offer, and it's the thought which counts." A few minutes later, what does he see? That these squirrels are rushing into the water, because remember, they are by the sea. So they're rushing into the waves of the ocean, wetting themselves, then rolling on the sand, the soft sand on the beach, and then rushing to where the stones are being lined up and shaking the sand off. They are smoothening the path of the army that will cross to go to Lanka. And this so moves Ram that he pets them, and our legend also says that that's why the squirrels in India always have those three stripes on their back. And it's true, I have noticed, in no other part of the world I've seen squirrels with stripes. So this is zoology come mythology. Now, why is this story? I mean, apart from the obvious reason that this is a story about how everybody is good at something, it's also about how nobody is too small for any task, right? But more than that, it is about when we are moved to act and we feel deeply compelled to join in an action, not out of pity, not even out of compassion, but because it's a chance to be greater than ourselves. Because it's a chance, it's an opportunity, it's an entry point to be part of something that is much larger than our little life. It's a chance to go from our little ego, which is also necessary, otherwise there's no existence, but to go from that little ego to the larger, the bigger ego, which is connected to a sense of not just universal connectedness in some abstract way, but in a very tangible sense of brotherhood that enriches life here and now, and at the same time connects this small finite being with the infinite. And this to me is the central seminal contribution of Gandhi, because Firoz asked me specifically to try and connect what inspiration we can seek from Gandhiji for this great mission. And I think this is maybe the essence of it, that Gandhiji inspired completely ordinary people to be worshipful squirrels, if nothing else. And mind you, in my universe, being a worshipful squirrel is a great thing. Huh? It's not a minor or a small contribution. He enabled very, and why did he do this? Why could he do this? Because this was his own story. I don't know how many of you know this, but that at the point when Gandhiji goes for the first time to South Africa, he's a failed lawyer. And he's in very deep trouble because his brothers had pretty much, you know, mortgaged the family resources in order to send him to England for that education to be a barrister. And he has come back, he's not able to make a success of the practice in Bombay. And now the family is in crisis because, you know, they're now short of funds. And so this, accepting this very small kind of a 2-3 month assignment to go and do one job for somebody in Africa, in South Africa, is a last ditch kind of option that he's exercising. So here is this extreme, and by the way, he is trained as a barrister, but why is he not a success as a lawyer in Bombay? Because when he goes in front of the judge, he's tongue-tied. He can't speak. I mean, you know, the person whose videos we are still watching, his speeches now, that person on that, at that stage of his life, he's tongue-tied. He's just completely, struck by stage fright. So this is the person who goes to South Africa and is thrown off that train. Okay, now think about it. If he were to have a small ego response to that experience, he would pack his bags the next day and go back and say, whatever it is, I'll sell bhaji, I'll do whatever, but I don't have to take this. I'm going back home. That would have been a very understandable response. I don't think too many people would have held it against him. But instead, something completely different happens. Instead of taking it as something personal, as an affront to his individual self, that incident connects him. That first time experience, it's a physical assault almost, because he's bodily thrown off the train. Of that experience of racial discrimination, of exclusion, transforms his life. And instead of running, he decides not only to stay and fight, but to do it in a way that has changed the nature of fighting, I hope, for all time to come. And it is through that exercise, in a very organic and in a very step-by-step way, that he comes to the conclusion that truth and nonviolence are the most viable, are the strongest, are the most true, the most authentic ways for us to journey on this path. And because it's organic, because it came from inside, it was not something, books helped, he had all sorts of other influences helping him, but actually a lot of that comes later. The book that changed his life, Onto This Last, by Ruskin, that happened much later. Even Tolstoy and the kingdom of within, that his engagement with the Christian idea of the kingdom that is inside you, all this comes much later. So there's a very raw, organic process by which he comes to these conclusions. And I'll close by highlighting, again, back to one story from the Ramayana, how and why, as we aim to not only focus our energies and, pitch our ambitions sufficiently high and yet also realizably, is that one is that nobody is too small, nobody has zero ability. But the other is that often we are not aware of our ability. And for that, the role model for me is Hanuman. I think many people here in the audience will know the story that as a baby, he had the power to fly. So much so that he one day went and, grabbed the sun. And that's a long story, we don't have time for it. But because of that, the god of the sky, Indra, took away his power to fly. And it is at the time when they are at the seashore, in an earlier chapter of the same story, Ramayana, that it takes one of the elders to tell him that, you don't know this, you have forgotten it, that you were deprived of that knowledge about yourself, but you are actually, you have the power to fly. And it is that ability to fly and reach the island across the ocean that is the fulcrum of this story. And I think it's a very powerful metaphor. And I'll close by leaving you with a line from a very favorite bhajan of mine. Ke hari se bada hari ka naam, ant mein nikla ye parinam, hari se bada hari ka naam. Because hari here is not only the Lord incarnate, which is the case in this story, but it is that idea, that symbol, that still small voice within you that connects us to the infinite possibilities, which otherwise we call the divine. Thank you. Namaskar.
जाओ पतंग लेके अपने ही रंग लेके आसमां का शाम में आना आज हमें है सजाना
ओके आई थॉट यू विल से आई एम रिपीटिंग द सेम स्टोरी सो आई डिडंट टेल इट ऑलराइट प्लीज प्लीज हैव अ सीट दिस वोंट टेक मोर देन 2 मिनट्स इट्स अ स्टोरी दैट हैज बिकम फेवरेट ऑफ फिरोज एंड द अदर फ्रेंड्स हियर सो आई वन ऑफ माय मेंटर्स सो एज यू कैन टेल पर्हैप्स दैट आई हैव बीन वेरी वेरी प्रिविलेज्ड इन लाइफ दैट आई हैव हैड सम ग्रेट मेंटर्स and I've been very held and guided. So one of them was Devendra Kumar. He's a veteran Gandhian. And he used to say this. He used to say, see, this process of social transformation is like making dahi. In English, you call it yogurt. So first of all, you need, the starter has to be dahi. You know, you can't make yogurt using cream or tofu or, you know, more milk. You have to have a sample of yogurt to make yogurt. So the starter has to be there, and this room is full of the starters. All of us here are the starter. Okay. The next thing is that the milk and the starter must be proportionate. You cannot set 1 gallon of milk into yogurt by having a quarter teaspoon of yogurt. It will have to be proportionate, and that you will figure out by trial and error. So that's why this summit, that's what the Inclusion Summit does. Okay, it's working to get the proportion of what Devendra Bhai used to call it adapters and evolvers. So all of us here are the evolvers, and we are in search of more and more people who may not choose to be evolvers. They may not have the time and energy, but they can be adapters, right? Third was that then the temperature of the milk must be right. If it's too cold, it won't set. And if it's too hot, it won't set. And that again is what the extended activity of this network of activism and missionary zeal for inclusion is about. It's trying to get the social climate to the right level so that then, you know, it'll be like a takeoff point. And by cascade, everything will begin to happen at a much faster and a much faster speed and larger scale, the change that we want. The fourth is that it won't do to just plonk the starter into the milk at the right temperature of the right proportion. You have to stir it. So there will be times when there's need for agitation. Okay? So I think that doesn't necessarily mean that, you know, we go and block the traffic. But agitation means that there is a time and a place also to be more assertive, non-violently, of course. And last but not least, and this is truly the hardest, you have to have patience. Because if you keep going and shaking the bowl to see if it's set or not, or poking a spoon into it, has it set or is it still milk, it'll never set. You have to leave it alone. And you have to leave it in the right kind of place. If it's winter and you leave the bowl outside, you know, near the window where the cold wind is coming, it won't set for 4 days. So the location, so that I think is what I think all the four conditions are there. Our only real creative challenge in this mission is that can we keep the faith? Can we keep the patience? Never to be either disheartened by any events or any happenings which look like it's too little, too low, too slow, and neither get overjoyed by the successes that we have. So patience, and which is in Hindi, dhairya, and udham, you know, that Hanuman spirit, okay, we can cross this ocean because Hari se bada Hari ka naam.